in the forest you'll find a fabulous banquet, a fairy ball. If you close your eyes and you open your mind, the veil disappears and you'll see it all.
Hi my angels, it's Haley Reese, and for today's video we are going to be diving into what I believe to be the most terrifying movie based on a true story. And we're gonna be diving into the true story behind the movie, The Exorcism of Emily Rose. Now this one has one of the most in detail true stories out of anything I've ever researched as far as true stories behind horror films going. And this is one of the very, very few films that left out so many horrific details from the real case. The real case was actually too scary to ever dream of bringing to Hollywood. I've wanted to cover this case for a very, very long time on my channel, but with that being said, it has to do with demonic possession and ultimately resulting in the death of a beautiful young girl who was possessed by multiple demons. So, as you guys know, I like to spread light and love and positivity here on my channel, and this is one of the few things that truly, truly, truly terrifies me, and that is demonic possession, and this movie in general and the true story is very, very freaky. So I want to give a very quick disclaimer before getting into this, and that is that light and love will always rule and beat out darkness. No matter what the devil tries to do, no matter what dark, negative, or evil entities try to take over, light and love and goodness, and in my beliefs, God, but whatever you believe, will always outpower darkness. So do not be afraid while watching this video. Just have it remind you that there are dark things out there, that very scary things in the paranormal world can happen, but as long as you believe in the power of light and love, darkness can never touch you. So I don't know if you guys have seen the film The Exorcism of Emily Rose. I saw this film years and years and years ago. I was probably about 13 when I saw this film, maybe even a little younger. And it traumatized me, you guys. You have no idea how badly this film scared me. However, when I started researching into the true story of the real girl that this all happened to and what she endured, and accidentally listening to some transcripts and some audio clips from her exorcism, I realized that the reality of it was far more terrifying, and what can happen in real life can sometimes be much more scary than Hollywood portrays. So Emily Rose was actually based on a young woman by the name of Annalise Mitchell, who died at the age of 23 after being said to have been possessed by 6 demons and enduring a year's worth of exorcisms. Now Annalise was described as generous, kind, respectful, and extremely, extremely religious. She attended church and mass at least twice a week and dedicated her life to really serving in the name of God and Jesus. She was respected by nearly anybody who came into contact with her. And Annalisa grew up with her 2 parents and her 3 sisters. She was also in a very loving and committed relationship with a boy by the name of Peter, who would stand by her side until the very end, which when you hear this story, he must have been an amazing guy and truly, truly love her. So let's start at the beginning where this all kind of began for Annalise. So Annalise, at the age of 16, experienced her first ever seizure and was actually in turn diagnosed with epilepsy. She spent some time in the hospital receiving treatment, and while she was in the hospital, she chose to utilize that time to really strengthen her relationship with God. Because Annalise had plans in the future to actually become somebody who teaches the principles of Christianity to others. So like I said, she endured this treatment within the hospital, and the treatment seemed to be successful. So she was able to return back to high school, where everything seemed relatively normal until it wasn't, which was kind of closer to the end of her high school year. Things spiraled downhill very, very quickly, and Annalise's health began to deteriorate to extreme. She was unable to support her own body weight. She actually had to hold onto chairs and walls and railings and anything that she could lean on to get her from point A to point B, as she could no longer even hold herself up, And Annalise also began to endure sporadic onsets of depression and suicidal thoughts. She began to feel extremely depressed out of nowhere and began to contemplate suicide, which was something she had never done before because she was very, very in touch with her religion. Suicide is just a big no-no as far as her religion actually went. But where things got really, really terrifying and started to become paranormal were one night at dinner. Annalise's mom recalls that at dinner time she looked over at Annalise's hands and they appeared to be nearly 2 times larger than her regular hands. Her hands were massive. And when Annalise noticed her hands, she is quoted saying, "I have black hands, forgive me, Savior." Which people have kind of interpreted as her way of seeing that her hands were of darkness, were of something dark and demonic. Then began her experiences of seeing horrific demons within the walls. She said that they had 7 crowns and 7 horns, and she would see them all throughout the walls of her house. This, along with numerous night terrors and demonic images appearing right in front of her. She would also be thrown violently to the ground anytime she would recite the Hail Mary or any sort of prayer. She would then be thrown violently to the ground, unable to even catch herself. She would get scratches and bruises and break bones and severely injure herself. Once she would be thrown to the ground, she would stand right back up, try to pray, and get thrown back to the ground again in a very unhuman-like way. So Annalise began laying pillows all around the ground so that when she would do her prayers, she would hopefully fall and land on a pillow. But she is quoted saying that that never worked because the devil was malicious, and when they would throw her to the ground, she would somehow manage to just miss all of her pillows and smash her head on the ground. This in turn led to her realizing that she would never have any sort of comfort again in her life, and she began sleeping on the stone floor of her home, which would last up to 3 years. So almost immediately, Annalise's mom contacted anybody that she could to perform an exorcism on her daughter. She just knew that it was something demonic, and Annalise repeated all the time throughout this entire ordeal that something demonic had a hold of her. She ended up getting in contact with Father Renz, who would actually be the main exorcist in this case. Now, he immediately sent her to as many doctors as he humanly could, trying to find some sort of a logical, physical realm explanation as to what was going on with Annalise. And that was when it was concluded that she had something similar to epilepsy and that it would need to be treated with medication. But Father Renz didn't actually believe that that was the case. So in accordance and as a requirement to the Catholic Church, he sent her to multiple psychiatrists to get a mental psychosis of her to see what exactly was going on. Because I don't know if you guys know this, but in order to get approval from the church to perform an exorcism, you have to basically rule out every sort of earthly explanation as to what's going on. You need to basically prove to them that this isn't a psychiatric disorder, that this isn't a physical illness, that this is a demonic possession before you'll actually get their approval. And I'll get into in a little bit why it is so important to have the Catholic Church's approval in this, but we'll get there in a moment. So we took her to numerous psychiatrists, and a lot of which actually said it would be impossible to treat her with medications as it was in fact possession, or it seemed to be possession to them. So after all of these doctors and medical professionals gave their professional opinions on Annalise, Father Renz actually made the decision to do a trial exorcism, which was essentially to perform a trial exorcism, which is what I just said, but what I mean by this is to do certain things to basically see if it really is a demon and if exorcisms are the route to go. So during this trial exorcism, he actually performed a test. And what he did was, with the power of his mind, he used his mind to communicate with the demons inside of her, and he essentially said, "Let this girl go in the name of God, whatever else." And that was when, almost immediately, Annalise began reacting. She went ahead to actually rip the rosary from his neck and destroy it, which the rosary is something extremely sacred and powerful, and only a demonic, powerful, powerful entity would be able to actually touch the rosary and destroy it. So right away, he knew this was not somebody with a mental disorder or epilepsy, as there would have been no way for her to know, as he didn't change his demeanor, that he had made that request. There was no reason for her to, right at that moment, react in the way that she had. So after this incident, Annalise was no longer able to pray. It was literally as though now she had crossed a line by reaching out to a priest, and she was no longer able to pray whatsoever. At this point, Father Renz and Father Alt were actually given permission by the Catholic Church to perform exorcisms on Annalise, which is very, very important, like I mentioned before, because once you gain permission from the Catholic Church to perform an exorcism, it's as though the power of Christ himself is partaking in the exorcism. So prior to that, it's like the priests are performing the exorcism in the name of Christ, in the name of God, in the name of Jesus, all of that. But once they gain permission from the Catholic Church and everything is done by the book, so to speak, it is as though Christ is partaking in this to really remove these demons from this girl. Now, during the first attempt, Father Renz actually performed the Roman Catholic ritual. And to his shocking surprise, the demons began speaking through Annalise without even being provoked. So they started to ask the two of them, both fathers, what are your names? Who are you? And it was made very, very clear that she was being possessed by six demons who I am not going to say their name, but I will write them in a light font on the screen if you are curious. It doesn't hurt you to read them, but I just don't want to personally say their names. And so it was made clear that she was being possessed by six demons. Now, if you're somebody who's interested in this stuff and you want to listen to the audio clips of her exorcisms and hear her speak in the voices of these people, they are all over YouTube. Feel free to do so. I personally am not going to subject you guys to listening to somebody speak possessed, and I also don't want to hear it myself, but you're more than welcome to look this up and you can hear them describing who they are as demons and what their job is and why they were condemned to hell. So they began performing exorcisms twice a week on her. Something really, really creepy that I want to know is that Annalise would say that she would actually see the demons dancing around and taunting the priests as they performed the exorcisms, and she actually would ask them, do you see them? And they would not see them, but she in fact could. This poor girl endured so much trauma during this time period. It's absolutely heartbreaking and astonishing and terrifying. So around this time, Annalise began becoming very, very violent to everybody. She would be violent towards her sisters, violent towards her boyfriend, Peter, which, by the way, stood by her side throughout this entire ordeal. Like, he must have loved her so, so much in order to stand by her side when she would become violent towards him. And wait till you hear how much she deteriorates and changes throughout this entire span. He loved her. Now here's where it gets really, really interesting to me, and it's something that I still don't understand in all of the research that I've done on the case of Annalise Mitchell, and that is one day she went out with Peter. Now bear in mind, her health had deteriorated to the point of horrific. She could barely walk on her own, and they went on a nice walk together, and all of a sudden she claimed she was met by Mother Mary, and all of a sudden every single bit of pain she had and suffering and everything that she was enduring just disappeared, and she was able to walk on her own. Now remember, Peter witnessed this. She said she walked alongside with Mother Mary, who essentially faced her with the choice of suffering for the sins of others so that they wouldn't go to hell. And she told her that she would have 3 days to make the decision of if she would suffer for the sake of the rest of the world and for everybody else's sins, that they wouldn't be damned to hell. And for those 3 days, essentially, I guess she was going to rid Annalise of all of her pain and suffering while she made the decision. Now, Annalise's mother begged and pleaded her not to take the deal. She said it seemed like a lot more suffering for a young girl who's already endured so, so much. But Annalise basically went on to say that she couldn't allow others to go to hell when she could essentially change that for them. So she decided to take the deal. And for those 3 days, she was completely able to walk on her own, to eat again, to function, which was absolutely wild, you guys, because during this span of time, she was biting into concrete walls. She was eating bugs off of the floor. She was licking up her own urine. She wasn't eating, she wasn't drinking, she was sleeping on the concrete floor. She was scratching the walls until her nails ripped off and bled. She was falling to the floor and breaking all of her bones. She would throw up and then she would eat her throw up and she would snarl and growl and coil up. It was horrific. So for her to go from that to 3 days of no suffering was just shocking to everybody. So eventually there came the day where the demons had to leave, and this day was revealed to Annalise through Mother Mary. She had told Annalise that she was going to expel the demons on this particular day. Now what's interesting, if you look through the transcripts of this part of the exorcism and if you listen to the audio clippings, when the demons are said to leave on a certain date, this is true in any exorcism, that date is most of the time exactly when they leave. They'll try to delay it, they'll try to prolong it, they'll try to play deceptive little tricks on you and on the priest, but essentially they will leave during that day. And so they started to stall, but they were less active than they ever were, just lightly growling through her. And finally, they're expelling each and every one of the demons, and one part gets really strange because the demons say to the priest, "We want to leave, but we can't." And the priests were shocked. They actually thought that they had done something wrong, because this is just unheard of as far as exorcisms go, for a demon to say it wants to leave but it can't. And many believe it's because, due to the deal that Annalise took with Mother Mary, they believe that maybe perhaps Mother Mary trapped the demons inside Annalise for when she would eventually die. Nobody exactly knows, but that is a really interesting part to take note of in this case. So Annalise told everybody that in July something would change. And on July 1st, 1976, at age 23, Annalise Mitchell died in her home. It is said that she died from starvation and dehydration, because throughout the time of all of these exorcisms, she had stopped eating, she had stopped drinking, she was completely letting herself go. She weighed something like 60 pounds, I think. She was severely underweight, she had cuts, bruises, scrapes, broken bones, broken teeth. Almost all of her teeth were broken from when she would bite into the concrete. It was so bad, actually, that before she had died, the priest had asked a doctor if he could prescribe her something to ease the pain. And the doctor actually replied that there was no injection against the devil. Now, after Annalise's death, her parents and the two Roman Catholic priests were found guilty of negligent homicide, and were actually sentenced to 6 months in jail, which was reduced to 3 years of probation, as well as a fine for what they had done to her. Interestingly and horrifically enough, the medical professionals who had given the advice that there was no treatment they could do for her, as they believed it was demonic possession, retracted their statements once in court because they didn't want to get in any sort of trouble. And so the priests, along with her parents, were kind of stuck in a bind with nothing but audio recordings of a girl screaming and speaking in tongue, although she was speaking in a language that she didn't even know, and none of it sounds any sort of human. And I really think this case and the sentences were very wrong, or that the family and the priest were very wrongly sentenced, but that's because I believe in it. I do understand that from the stance of a jury and from the stance of a judge, it does seem far-fetched, but it's one of those things that unless you experience it, you can't really believe it. And it looked as though she had been abused. I mean, in the sense of she was malnourished, she was dehydrated, she was underweight, she had all of her teeth broken, she was cut and bruised and scraped and broken boned and just in such a poor state when she died, that her family and the priests were the ones who suffered when this was at the hands, in my opinion, of the devil. Now, one thing that I want to say is her mother actually claims that this activity never fully stopped after the death of Annalise Mitchell, and that she still experiences demonic-like things around her, although not to the degree that her daughter did and not to the degree of when her daughter was still alive and well, but she believes that it will always follow her. So after this, they came out with the movie The Exorcism of Emily Rose, which was based on the experiences of Annalise Mitchell. However, it was very, very, very downplayed, which is traumatizing to think, because that movie terrified me. And her mother wanted absolutely nothing to do with the movie, said that she had no intentions of viewing it, wanted nothing to do with it, because she lived through it, and what she lived through was way more horrifying than what Hollywood could ever put on film. think what happened to Annalise Mitchell is an absolutely horrific thing, especially for a girl who was so religious. It terrifies me that this can happen. It terrifies me, the concept of it all. What confuses me is the part of Mother Mary and how Annalise was to essentially suffer for the sins of others and to keep them from going to hell. The entire case is terrifying. You're more than welcome to go ahead and do your research into the transcripts and into the real audio recordings of her exorcism, as they are accessible on the internet. What I did, because I wanted to know everything that was said in the exorcism, was I read the transcripts of it. I didn't actually listen to it because I didn't want to subject myself to that. And if I can give you guys any sort of advice, if you want to know what's said in these exorcism moments, I would suggest just reading the translations of it all instead of listening to it, because it's very, very dark, disturbing, and disgusting. I want to say one more thing, and that is, like I said, light, love, and goodness will always, always overcome evil, darkness, and demonic entities. We are so much stronger than that. Our light is so much brighter. And so don't be afraid leaving this video. Just use it as an educational purpose to know why to keep your light bright and loving, and know that, like I always say, you can't believe in one without the other. If there's good in the world, there has to be bad as well. Well, you guys, I hope that you enjoyed this video. I tried my very best to go as much into detail as I could. I spent hours researching this. I wanted it to be the most in-depth video on YouTube to do with the case of Annalise Mitchell and the truth behind the exorcism of Emily Rose. I really hope that you guys enjoyed it. Please make sure to leave a comment down below letting me know what you thought of all of this, and I will see you guys in tomorrow's video. If you guys are new to my channel, or you are just not yet subscribed but you do enjoy my videos, I would love it if you would go ahead and click that subscribe button. I post a ton of videos, so I don't want you to miss my upload. And please give this video a big thumbs up if you did enjoy it, because I do lots of research and it makes my heart so happy when I know that you guys enjoy it. So please do that. Remember, my loves, do all things with kindness. And until next time, I love you.